Good morning and welcome to Grace Baptist Church. We're glad you're here with us. If you're visiting, please, in the back of your pew, there's a visitor's card. Please fill those out, drop it in the offering basket or over here on the table. And also, if this is your first time or second or third time, please stop into the Welcome Center. We have a gift for you, a gift bag. If you've been here for quite a while, if you've changed any of your information, your email, your phone number, etc., that's the best way to keep up with us. Just please fill out those changes and turn them in so we can keep you updated with all the activities that are going on in the church. But also, you can look on our website as another way. April 1st is our community Easter egg hunt. It was a great turnout last year. We got to reach into the community. This year, it's going to be at 1 o'clock. What we need, we have a list sign-up sheet for volunteers. If you haven't done so yet and you'd like to, please sign up for that. Also, another thing that we need is candy and those plastic disposable eggs. Last year we threw them all out because of COVID risk. We didn't want to reuse them and sanitize them, so we need some more eggs. Down in the fellowship hall, there's two bins. If you are able to drop off any of those, you can drop them off down there. And next Sunday, right after church, there's going to be a quick meeting, probably 10, 15 minutes, for anybody who's able to help volunteer with the Easter egg hunt, just so we can get up to speed with who's available and what we're doing. So please stay, leave a little time for staying for that. Yeah. This Tuesday evening at 6:30, Women's Ministry is starting up a series Encountering God Through Spiritual Disciplines from Kelly Minter. And that begins this Tuesday. Today after service is our first Sunday fellowship down in the gym. Please stay after service for a time of fellowship and food, and it's a great time to get together. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this time you've given us to gather together to worship you. Thank you for this family that you've given us, Lord. Thank you for your love for us, Father. Just pray that you will bless us with your word and our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. So that you stand as we spend some time in worship. Well, the whole service is worship, but this portion of it is going to be with our singing.
Praise you, God, I fall. things I would rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. No place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place that I'd rather be than hearing your love, hearing your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God.
Yeah.
This morning, Lord, your presence. You are deserving of all things. You give us all things. And Lord, to you may our lives always point. Lord, this morning as we gather together, we just come to you with humble hearts. Lord, some with broken hearts. Lord, some with hearts that just are crying out to you. And Lord, I would ask that you minister to each one of us. Wherever we are, Lord, we don't have to come before you with anything other than exactly who we are. We don't have to clean ourselves up, Lord. We don't have to fix ourselves up, Lord. We just need to come to you, to bow down before you, Almighty King, who loves us dearly. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. In Jesus, in your name we pray. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Everybody doing good?
Amen.
All right, amen. We had like 2 snowstorms this week, and today spring's back.
Hey, all right.
Oh, people are excited. And as David mentioned, don't forget, after service downstairs, we have our first Sunday fellowship. I heard some good things. I know our ace coffee maker is back from Florida. That's good. And yeah. And I think his lovely wife brought a special banana bread recipe back from Florida. That, I don't know if that's what I heard, but I heard something like that. And I know there's all kinds of goodies, and it was pretty neat. I went downstairs, and I found a whole lot of coins on the tables, too, so I picked them all up. And And so make sure you come down after that. And fellowship, talk with somebody you don't know, somebody you just met, somebody who you've never seen before. Spiritual fellowship is kind of what we've been talking about. But it is wonderful. We have a lot of things going on. As David mentioned, we have our GBC happenings. We have some clipboards over there. We need you to volunteer and to sign up to help and serve and love and take care of. And it's a great way to meet people in the church. So lots of things going on over there. And Also, we're going to be celebrating the Lord's Supper in a few moments. If you didn't get your fellowship cup, they're over here, they're over there, and they're in the back. Also, your sermon notes are there. They're at each door. So you can pick up a little sheet of paper just to kind of guide you along through today's sermon. So what we're going to do now is the ladies are going to come forward and we're going to take up the offertory. Always a chance to give back to the Lord. And as we always say, I always say it, but it's important to understand how grateful, you know, the community is and this church is for the faithful givers that have given so much over the years to this church. And I believe God has a great plan for us as we move forward. And we're going to continue to give, we're going to continue to support, we're going to continue to share with our tithes and our offerings. So I'm going to pray, and then they'll have another song. And then we will celebrate the Lord's Supper after that. Lord God, we just thank you for the chance we have to give to you. Lord, as we give our tithes and offerings, we thank you for your grace that you have had time and time again on all of us, on this church, Lord, on our lives. And Lord, as we give, we do so cheerfully. We do so with an understanding and a trust and a faith based in your promises that you will do far greater things than we can even imagine. So Lord, take our tithes and offerings. Bless them, Lord, and do what you will with them. We love you, Lord, and praise you, and Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
We walk in sin that I cannot see.
Sunday of every month, we celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And I think it's always important that, you know, as we do it together, because even as Jesus celebrated, he brought his followers, his disciples, together to do it with him and in fellowship with each other. And I think that is so important for us to remember, and that's why we do it this way. And oftentimes I'll have questions, well, can I partake in it? Can I do this? Depending on your religious tradition, there's always been many rules, it seems like. What we ask here is that you simply be a follower of Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ, you know him as your Lord and Savior, and then we're going to celebrate together. So if you need a fellowship cup, just slip your hand up, we'll get you one. And everybody's good. So how we do it is, we'll get them for you. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
And I'll be sharing in a moment from 1 Corinthians 11. But before that, Keith, who is co-chair of our diaconate, he comes up and he opens us up in prayer over the bread. Then I'll read the scripture and then we'll take it together. In a moment of reflection, and then Keith will come back and he'll pray over the juice. And then we will take that together with a moment of reflection. And again, we understand that we're doing this in memory of what Jesus did. And we're also doing it looking forward to remember what he promised us, that he will be returning one day. So this is just a hope-filled celebration that we have. So Keith, if I can ask you to come up and pray.
Dear Lord, humbly we come together today and thanking you for our freedom that we have to come here. As we take this piece of bread, we do thank you for the symbol of your broken body. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Now I will read from 1 Corinthians 11. Starting in verse 23 through 24. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So now we take the bread together. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So now we drink together. Blessed beyond anything we can imagine. Love you, Lord. Thank you for your grace. What we always do on the first Sunday also is we take up our diaconate benevolent collection, and as Brenda and Cheryl come forward, what we do with this is kind of, I would say maybe a crisis fund that we can use in moments of great need, in moments of crisis. We've reached many places over the years. So we take this up once a month, and it's not money that comes in to operate the church, it's money that goes out to touch the lives of people. What we're always clear is this is believers, non-believers, it doesn't matter. We use this to do what God calls us to do. So I'm going to pray over this and then give what the Lord calls. Lord, we thank you for this chance to give to you. Lord, we thank you that you have put such generous people in this church. Over so many years, we've been able to reach into the needs of our community and serve those. Lord, and to share your love, regardless of who the person is, whatever it is they need, wherever they are. So, Lord, I would just ask again, as we pray before, when we give to you, that you do far greater things than we can even imagine. We thank you, Lord. We love you and we praise you. And Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen. Service gets going, just thank you to all the people who make things happen in the service. Obviously, you see our worship team here, and in behind the scenes, we have the media person who Don is doing the slides today, and we also have David who's in sound, and then you see our ushers and our collectors. And so I just really appreciate all the work that goes into it. And next week we're going to it's our second week of the month. We do Ministry Minute. And next week you're going to have a chance to meet and learn a little bit about the chairperson of our board. I think she just cringed when I said that, right? Because she didn't come up, and we're going to have a chance to pray for Brenda. And she's going to tell us a little bit about her role. We'll learn a little bit more about her. So I really do appreciate all of the volunteers and all that takes place behind the scenes to make our service operate. And of course, we have volunteers who were down early this morning getting First Fellowship hour set up. But today is the wrap-up in our sermon series, Growing as a Church. And what we've been doing is in the growing as a church, because in order to grow as a church, we have to grow as individuals in Christ so that we can grow together, because people, we are the church. And this has been about spiritual disciplines. And we don't always like the word discipline. But you have to remember where that word comes from. It comes from the word disciple. Somebody who is learning, somebody who is being molded, somebody who is being changed. And our final discipline that we're going to cover, our final area of growing, title this morning, is Fast with the Church. And this is about a little used, it's not used as much, you see, but fasting. And we're going to take a look at what we're called to do as believers, why we're called to it, the ways in which we can do it, and then we're going to have a challenge at the end of the message for us as a church to come together to see what God wants to do. So what I'd like to do is I want to open us in prayer. Lord, I just thank you once again this morning that we can be here. Lord, we can never have too much of a time calling on you. Lord, prayer is the communication that you have given us to speak with you, the creator of everything, the one who loves us, the one who cares for us, the one who is with us, the one who moves with us, who moves for us, and who will never leave us nor forsake us. We thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, this morning I would just ask that you prepare our hearts. Lord, prepare our hearts to hear and look at the biblical principle of fasting. Lord, something that is not always on the top of our minds, Lord. Lord, it is such a wonderful way, a gift that you have given us to bring us into further relationship with you. So, Lord, I would just ask that you do challenge us this morning, that you do continue to grow us in every way. Lord, and there's the hard things that we're going to hear, and there's maybe the easy things, the things we like to hear, the things we don't like to hear. But, Lord, this is your word for us. We thank you for who you are. We love you and praise you. In Jesus, in your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. So again, spiritual disciplines. Nobody likes discipline. Because if you're on the receiving end of the discipline, you definitely don't like it. And if you're on the giving end of the discipline, most don't like it. Maybe there's a few who do, and we've got to work on that. That might be another sermon for another day. But when we think about the disciplines, when we think about the disciplines that we're given as we look at our relationship with God, they're all about us growing closer to Him. And what could be better than that? So this morning, we're going to take this look at fasting. And I'm going to open us up in the prophet, the book of Zechariah, in chapter 7, verse 5. This is God's word through the prophet Zechariah. And remember, when the prophet spoke to the people, it wasn't always met with great popularity. It wasn't always met, oh great, the prophet's about to speak God's word. I can't wait to hear what thus saith the Lord is going to say now. Because often we find the prophets met with their untimely demise, put to death by the people. But the word of God came to Zechariah and he spoke. Say to all the people of the land and to the priests, when you fasted and mourned in this fifth and seventh months, these 70 years, was it actually for me that you fasted? So picture the context in which we're working here, in which the people are hearing this. My goodness, they're wonderful people. They've fasted all these years. They've been fasting at least twice a year, the fifth and the seventh month, over a period of 70 years, over a period of time. They are really good and holy people. God says, well, I want to challenge you. Why are you doing this? Because the fast that is talked about here is the fast in reference to the governor Gedaliah, who was appointed by King Nebuchadnezzar in about 586 BC. This was all taking place. The people were fasting over the death of the governor Gedaliah. And as we look, we can go into 2 Kings, and we just get a little bit of the context and the history. And as we look in verse 22, now as for the people who were left in the land of Judah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had left, he appointed Gedaliah, the son of Ahikam, the son of Shaphan, over them. Verse 24, Gedaliah swore to them and their men and said to them, do not be afraid of the servants of the Chaldeans. Live in the land and serve the king of Babylon, and it will be well with you. So as we see, this man, Governor Gedaliah, was appointed And he was a good and decent ruler. Yes, they had been brought into exile, but here he was saying to the people, I know these Chaldeans have terrified you, have done horrible things, but I'm going to watch over you. And then when he passed, the people were at a loss. And the question that God brings to them through Zechariah is he's saying, what are you fasting for? Are you fasting out of genuine sorrow for a loss of somebody? Or are you fasting out of self-pity? You see, the fast of the people had been misdirected. They were thinking of their fasting because, oh, we need another good governor who can take care of us. I feel bad. This isn't good. Where God is saying, that's not the reason I want you to fast. Don't you trust me? Don't you have faith in me? Should you not be fasting to grow closer to me? They weren't fasting out of true sorrow and repentance. They were fasting out of self-pity. And God addresses that a number of times in his word. As we look at another prophet, Isaiah. He brought before the people in Isaiah 58:6 and said, speaking God's word, is this not the fast which I choose, to loosen the bonds of wickedness, to undo the bands of the yoke, and to let the oppressed go free and break every yoke? See, God time and time again has come to the people, speaking through the prophets, saying, why are you doing these ceremonies? Why are you walking around fasting? Why are you walking around like this? The act of fasting, when people fasted, God wanted people's hearts. And that's what he's been looking for. And that's what he always looks for. And that is the question that we want to take as we move forward over the next couple of weeks and we get closer to doing a fast together if you choose. But we're going to start today, and we want to answer the question, where is my heart in relationship to you this very morning, God? Why do I do the things that I do? Lord, do you have my heart? Because I firmly understand and know that God wants each one of our hearts this morning. And what we're going to come to understand today as we work through some scriptures on fasting, we do not fast to direct God, but rather we fast to put ourselves in a position to be directed by God. See, the fasting part raises up our countenance to God and lowers down our serving of self. And the second part is, as the people of God, we should always consider that which is in the best interest of God's kingdom to be in our best interest. Because if God's kingdom is going to move forward, if his work is going to move forward, if we are going to be challenged to move in God's kingdom, to do what he calls us to do, we better make darn sure we're focused on what he wants us to do, that we're being directed by him. Because when we move out of God's will, when we step out of the kingdom work, that's not in our best interest, is it? And I want you to be challenged this morning to say, Lord, my best interest is to be doing kingdom work. What is the kingdom work that you're calling me to do? And get me ready to step into it. Now, I get excited about this. I get excited. I've been excited as we've been planning this and and talked to some of the leadership in the church and said, this would be something that would be good. As a church, if you can, we're going to talk about that if you can, but to fast together. Because we're going to be praying together for God's kingdom to move in our lives, in our church, in our communities. We're going to be doing it together. We're going to be supporting each other. And then we're going to celebrate it together. You know, God's kingdom work that he allows us to operate in, that's grace. That is unmerited grace. Who are we? Who am I, Lord, that you allow me to operate in your kingdom and to do your kingdom work? I get excited. I don't know about you. Maybe say, no, I'd really rather not do God's kingdom work. I just want to take care of my own interests. Well, if you're feeling that this morning, that's okay. Let's take a little step, though, and see what can happen when we step into kingdom work. Now, and fasting is part of getting focused on that kingdom work. Author Richard Foster pointed out between the years 1861 and 1954, he's done a study. He's one of the leading authors on fasting. But he found out in that nearly 100 years, you know how many books were written on fasting? Zero. Hey, that trick. Those would be a lot. And then he thought, I was going to say, well, I ordered them all, but I hadn't done that. Zero books between 1861 and 1954 were written on fasting. So if you go on Amazon and you put it, because I do these things, and you put in the word fasting, you know, biblical fasting. We're not talking about fasting. We're talking about biblical fasting. There are more books than you can imagine. But it seemed like between 1861 and 1954, the church was doing a lot of fasting. Now we can read about some history there. We see some of the great leaders in the church were fasting. We had no books about fasting, but people were fasting. Now we have a lot of books about fasting, but yet we don't really do much of it. Seems funny. Because if we look at religion, there's feel-good religion. We're not really about feel-good religion here. It means you're not always going to get your ears tickled when you come in and you hear God's word. But we're okay with that because we want to grow. But feel-good religion says that's not to be bothered with humility, hunger, and self-denial. You know, if that's what you want, you can go find that. And those are the same people that are preaching, well, you know, everybody will go to heaven. There's really no hell. Yeah, no need to fast. No need to be disciplined in your approach to God. No need to get to know him more. See, that's feel-good religion. You see, and that's what sometimes what the world wants. But Jesus didn't promise that. Jesus actually didn't say anything about religion. Jesus said there will be trials, there will be tribulations. One day you'll be with me in eternity. And nothing can take you out of my hand. He will never leave us nor forsake us. But there's going to be some mountains along the way. And Jesus himself said, let me show you what they might look like as he went to the cross. And then there's the worldly view. Why would fasting not be popular for getting to be closer to God? The worldly view is you can have it all. We say, I can have it all. That'll block the thoughts of sacrifice and humility from our minds. I can have it all. I don't need to do anything. It's just going to come to me. And God is saying, no, when you fast, you'll get to know more of me. Now, if we don't fast, that in no way jeopardizes our salvation. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that when we fast, we can get closer to God. Fasting is done to be touched by God and for us to be touched by him. And I think that's what makes it exciting. As we fast, we would find ourselves touched by God. And we'll be clearing things, clearing the deck, so we can touch him in a greater way. See, I want to encourage us all as a church to take some steps. And in 2 weeks, when we're here on the 19th for service, maybe a bunch of us will be fasting together. That It's going to be our challenge. We're going to work with that. But, you know, we got to look at the expectations of fasting. You know, so, well, yes, it's an old, like a lot of the spiritual disciplines. Well, that was an Old Testament thing. I live in the New Testament. You know, I got Jesus. You know, that God in the Old Testament, he's not around. You know, it's different now. All these things are different. Oh, yes, we know that Jesus has appeased the wrath of God, the wrath that we deserve. Praise you, Lord, for that. Thank you. Yeah, that's unmerited grace. But it seems like a lot of disciplines, if we start looking at the disciplines we've covered, well, yeah, well, you know, the people stood for days upon days just reading Scripture. And we don't have to do that anymore. So we don't need to read Scripture. Well, you know, tithing, that was an Old Testament thing. Well, I think we proved that there's aspects of tithing, tithes and offerings that Jesus is looking for us. Say, well, fasting, yeah, they had to do that because that was part of the atonement. So they had to be fasting all the time. But if we really look at Scripture, because we don't want to do anything, we don't want to make man-made rules, we want to see what the expectations of Jesus are of his people. Because you know what, as I look out, and I know that each one of you who are here, each one of you who are watching, you're people who are craving Jesus. You're craving to know him more. You're seeking him more. You're giving of yourselves so we can know Jesus more. And what I want us to see this morning is that fasting is another step that we can take together. To see more of Jesus, to show more of Jesus, and to know more of Jesus. See, when we look in the New Testament, I go right to one scripture. People say, no, Old Testament, that's fasting. New Testament, we don't fast. In Matthew 6:16, Jesus says, whenever you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do, for they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men when they say they are fasting. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. Now there's a lot we can get into, but I'm only looking at the first three words. Whenever you fast. So what is Jesus saying there? He has an expectation that his followers will fast. So I think we've eliminated the fact that fasting it's an Old Testament thing. But we do want to understand that there's fasting guidelines. And what I want to be clear is I'm focusing today on the traditional biblical fast, which is the elimination of food from your diet, which is not eating. I know that we can say, well, there's a lot of other ways I can fast, Pastor. Yes, there are. I want to challenge us as a church to really look at the biblical fast, which is involving food. So that's where my focus is going to be today. And fasting guidelines. So when we fast, we are operating in the Holy Spirit, attempting to grow and advance on our spiritual journey. And in doing so, we are claiming ground that belongs to the kingdom of God. Because this all belongs to God. This means, when we're claiming the ground for the kingdom of God, this means we're taking away ground from the enemy. We're taking away ground that the devil has his hand on. And no movement of the Holy Spirit will ever go unchallenged by the enemy. So I'm giving you some expectations of when you fast. Because right now, I know, I've been there. Oh, I have all these reasons that I'm not going to be able to fast. You know, and again, I'm going to talk, if there's serious safety issues with your health, don't fast. If you have questions, You say, I really want to get involved in this with the church, but I'm not sure, I have some medical issues. We have 2 weeks before we're going to do it as a church. Please pick up the phone and talk with your medical person. Call your primary care physician and say, look, our church is fasting. I know I have this, that. Would I be able to participate safely with this? That's using discernment. But if you start saying all the reasons, well, I know on this day you're talking about, I'm going to have a big meeting to do. I got to do this. I got to do that. I want to get this done. Those are the things the enemy's just throwing in there. Because when we fast and we grow closer to God, the devil acts up. And he starts moving. So I'm giving you expectations. And when you take the step to do this, the devil's going to spend the next 2 weeks working for you. But we're going to spend the next 2 weeks praying about it. Praying together. Saying, Lord, we can do this. And we're going to do this. And Lord, we have great expectations of what you're going to do. I want you to be excited about it. Because, you know, we're going to challenge ourselves with a little fast. And then we'll see where the Lord takes us. I don't know. So what are the reasons we fast? Now we all know. The reason, one of the reasons we're fasting is not to lose weight. You know, we understand that there's the medical reason that sometimes you have to fast before a medical test. We're not talking about that. And we're not like, oh, it's healthy. Well, yes, when we're seeking the best interest of God, when we're fasting, we just might find out that there's some really good health reasons before it that surround fasting. But that's not why we're doing it. Because the first reason that we fast is that it grows us in our godly disciplines. Because what's funny, as we fast and we look, we're going to see that all these other disciplines around us, the prayer, the learning, the having spiritual conversations with other people, the true fellowship of a spiritual nature, those are all going to grow as we fast. And as we look at Matthew 4:4, we start to see again, but he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. When we begin to fast, it starts to move us into utter dependence on God, his grace, his presence, and his mercy. It moves us from craving the bread into craving the bread of life. Jesus told us, I am the bread of life. You see, so the spiritual discipline of fasting moves us. But you know, we're going to say, Lord, I'm not sure if I can do this. We'll be 2 hours into the fast and say, Lord, this is rough. I might get 8 hours into a fast and say, Lord, this is really hard. And that's going to come in the midst of your hunger pangs. Say, I'm weak, Lord. I'm weak. I don't know what I can do. And I love what one of my old mentors used to say, Joe Jacob, Hillside Church. First time I ever fasted. We did it as a small group of us. What? I was a new Christian. I had just been, just started coming to church. He said, I'm going to get hungry. He said, let me make it real simple for you. Pastor Joe he didn't always mince words. He just came right out and said it. So when you get hungry, pray. Okay. And we've always taken that down. And I were talking about that last night. Said, that was probably the greatest advice we ever had. When you're going to get hungry, you think you can't do it, pray. I remember some specific fast that Don and I did. We were doing one at Hillside, and we had to travel for your work up to New Hampshire. I can't fast for traveling to New Hampshire. Well, you're going to have a lot of time to pray in the car then, aren't you? Oh, I'm hungry. We're in New Hampshire. We're near Vermont. Good cheese. Pray. I remember, I think Don was in the Dominican Republic. And so I don't know really what else to do. I'm kind of lost here, you know. I'm just going to fast. I got to trust you, Lord. And as I fasted, it just brought me closer to him in those moments. Those are two moments that always come clear to me. The reasons that we fast is it'll help us grow our godly disciplines. Saying, I haven't done so good since you preached about prayer 3-4 weeks ago, Pastor. I haven't done good. Fasting will help you. I haven't really done good about the spiritual fellowship thing.
A lot of times when you're fasting, it's nice to pick up the phone. I don't know if you don't, you know, if you're fasting with your spouse, you can turn to your spouse and say, hey, you know, single guy, pick up the phone. I'm fasting, man, this is rough. Pick up the phone, call one of your other single guy friends and say in the church and say, hey, or call one of the other guys you know. Hey, ladies, when you're fasting, call up one of your sisters in Christ and say, hey, I'm fasting, I'm really struggling here. You know, that's important. Pray together, spiritual fellowship. We're learning more about God as we fast. You can say, hey, what's God been talking to you through this fast? You know, you notice I said something there, and I want to be clear on this. As we do these spiritual disciplines, I want to talk about praying. I want to talk about the way we've been, we called each other. I want to talk about this if we're reaching out to each other. It is best in the kingdom of God that if I need to speak with somebody about my fasting, I call, for a spiritual thing, I call one of my brothers in Christ. I can also speak with my wife, of course. But if you don't have a spouse to speak to, men, speak with men about your spiritual issues. Women, speak with women about your spiritual issues. And there's reasons I say this, and there's reasons that in the kingdom that we want to do this. So I just wanted to be clear on that. That we're, you know, because sometimes when you're dealing with something very spiritual in nature, something that's going on, you need to be talking to a brother. Ladies, you need to be talking to a sister. So, but as we fast, you know, it might be preparing us to get closer to God, and it might be we're going to be prepared for when that great trial comes. Spiritual disciplines will grow as we fast. Amen. And you know what? If the only result that comes from fasting is that we grow closer to God, praise God for that. Amen. Reasons we fast. For clarity and direction in an area of our lives, and also to push through and into and act on that clarity and direction. I think if you want to take a look at Esther 4:16. Esther said, "Go assemble all the Jews who are found in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maidens also will fast in the same way. And thus I will go into the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish." Esther teaches us two incredible things right there. And that as you fast, it will prepare you to take the action that God desires. It will give you the clarity and direction. As Esther fasted for those 3 days, she knew without a doubt that she was going to have to stand before the king to protect the lives of the Jews in the countryside around. And the fast, along with pushing her to act on that, what did it help her overcome? Fear. Fasting will move you, give you clarity on where God wants you to act, give you the impetus to push through, and will take you through oftentimes the fear that is set before you. Lord, I know you want me to do this, but I cannot do that. Look what Esther said. Lord, I'm going to fast, I'm going to go, I'm going to do, and I'm not going to fear death. If I die, I die. Because the church in 2023 has been overcome with fear. We're afraid to speak out into the world as to what God's truth says. We fear that if we speak and we say, this is not according to God's word, I'm afraid what people are going to think and do. I'm afraid to speak the truth. I'm afraid to speak what doctrine says about God's creation, about God's sanctity of life, of about the things that we're supposed to do. If the church, that's the big C, the big church, weren't so caught up in fear sometimes, we might be seeing some more ground being claimed for the kingdom. So fasting can help move us in a personal way through fear and a communal way through fear. And then a third reason I want to give us as we look at fasting is we sometimes need to be fasting when we are caught in the long track of sinning and disobedience. When we're caught in the long track of sinning and saying, Lord, I have an idea and I know what your desires are, I'll get to them. Fasting is going to give us such great clarity, not only on what those desires of God are, but on how we can work to move into the desires. We look in Proverbs 24:31-32. And behold, it was completely overgrown with thistles. Its surface was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. When I saw, I reflected upon it. I looked and received instruction. This isn't just about a garden. This is about where sometimes we are at a point in our lives where we say, Lord, I need to fast because I have a long track of sin that I've been dealing with in my life. I want to move past it. I can't move past it. Lord, I need clarity because I want to do your kingdom work. Maybe you say, well, maybe it's just not sin. It's just that I've been lacking in some obedience. Maybe you say, Lord, I don't even know where that area of disobedience is. Maybe we're struggling in the areas of lust. Maybe we're struggling in the areas of addiction. Maybe we're struggling in the areas of deceit and work. Maybe we've been messing a long time with the expense account at work. I don't know. I'm just throwing things out there. Maybe I've been disobedient in the area of pride, Lord. It's not just about a garden, but sometimes we get caught on that long track. The prophet Haggai said in chapter 1, verse 5, as he's just getting ready to speak to the people, prophet Haggai, good old fire and brimstone, he said, consider your ways. And that's what this proverb is saying. And that's what fasting will allow us to do, to consider our ways. We don't want to deal with our souls in the same way we sometimes see a careless businessman deal with his business, and the business goes down the drain. We're so quick sometimes we look at a business. Oh, look at that business went on, is going down the tubes. Well, the owner's terrible. You know what? He doesn't do anything. Well, you know what? Sometimes we might find our souls in a real dark spot, heading down a bad road. And we're quick to look at somebody else, but we're saying, God might be saying as we fast, your soul has been in a dark spot for a while. It's time to get cleaned up. It's time to move. Sometimes we're quick to jump on others, but we're not quick to jump on cleaning up our souls. A time of sin often requires a time of mourning, a time of humbling, time and work that can be shown to us as we engage in the discipline of fasting. You know, as we look at this proverb, we find out the work needed to overcome long-term sin requires more than a casual glance on it. But it requires a full turning over of everything. Amen. I'm not just talking about gardening, as the proverb says, but we can look at the gardening analogy. Sometimes, to get the garden to grow again, because it came up one year and there was a lot of weeds along with my tomatoes. Take it all up, start all over, turn the soil. That's hard work, though. It's hard work to get the weeds out of those tomatoes, isn't it, Tim? I've got a tomato guys in here. It's hard work. We're willing to do it in our gardens. We're willing to do those things around the house sometimes. Are we willing to do it for our souls? It might take some heavy lifting. And I want to tell you that I believe if we go into fasting with an open heart, God's going to start working and moving some of those heavy stones. You know, I love when I think about fasting. I learned a lot about fasting. As I think pretty much everybody knows, I attended Liberty University and then Liberty Seminary. And the founder of Liberty Seminary was a really amazing man, Jerry Falwell Sr. And I learned a lot about fasting from him because they had us read much of what he talked about and wrote his firsthand account of fasting. I don't know if you know, but Liberty University has the largest enrollment of any university, I believe, in the world right now. They've done things that other universities or colleges copy. In 1998, they claimed 1998, they claimed, because they were still kind of in the infancy, that they had 2,000 graduates pastoring churches, and 800 of those graduates had planted new churches in a place where the gospel wasn't present.
Wow.
But the story is interesting about Jerry Falwell. There's a lot of things that you hear about him, but he was a man of faith. And he told the story how Liberty was in a really bad place. They weren't going to be able to pay the bills. Jerry himself was quite popular in political circles. He did found the moral majority. He was really one of the first pastors to be in the political arena, to have a say in what went on. He was a powerful force. But his vision had always been for Liberty University to grow. He often said, I want to be what Brigham Young is to the Mormons and Notre Dame is to the Catholics. But back in the 70s and 80s, things weren't so good and the university was on the verge of closing. But Jerry was doing well. He said, this isn't. And he said, Lord, I'm going to fast and you got to help me. And the Lord said, you just fast. You don't worry about what I'm going to do. The Lord spoke clearly to him, he said. So he fasted for 40 days, Jerry fasted. 40 days. And he said he consulted a doctor, and he had to drink 8 ounces of V8 juice once a week, and he took a Centrum vitamin. That's what he did. And he came out of the fast. He said, Lord, we're still in a problem. And he waited 20 days. 20 days later, he felt the call from the Lord. Okay, it's time to fast again. Now I'm going to start showing you what you have to do. It's at that point that Jerry walked away from the moral majority. He said, I'm done with that. My focus has to be on Liberty. I can't have any of that notoriety. I can't be on TV anymore. I can't do that. Said he had a beautiful office in downtown Lynchburg, Virginia. Lord said, take one of those small offices. You can run this. You run the university from the university. It's time to humble yourself. And then the Lord started doing some wonderful things as Jerry fasted in those next 40 days. Here we are today where Liberty has an enrollment of over 100,000 people. That affects God's kingdom in great ways. In the span of 105 days, Jerry Falwell fasted for 80 days, through 40 hours. So I've always been amazed by that. And when I read it, I want to say, well, Jerry, what were you asking for? What were you asking God to do? God was speaking to him. He was growing closer to God. And as he said, he learned in fasting, it is never about what we want and are seeking, but what God wants, and he is seeking. I want to challenge us as we take a step, I'm going to show you in a minute, under the power of the Holy Spirit, where we can find out what God desires and what God is looking for us to do in our lives and as a church. Put that final slide up there. Thank you, John. I want to challenge us to fast as a church. You might have seen this go out in a couple of emails. Oops. Thank you. What I'd like to would challenge us to do is on Saturday, March 18th, at sundown, eat your last meal. That's Saturday night. Yeah, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, whenever the sun goes down, right around there. I know we're not legalists. We'll start fasting then. Say, I'll have dinner. And then I'm not going to eat again. All the way through Sunday night. And then Sunday night, I would like everybody to come out. It's the third Sunday of the month, so we have our prayer night anyhow. So we're going to come together to pray. We're going to move it an hour earlier to 5. We're going to come from 5 to 6. We're going to come in here and we're going to pray. We're going to worship. I'm telling you, if you haven't come to a prayer night yet, you're missing out. Because we had an amazing time of prayer last month. And I expect God to do even greater things because we're going to be so focused on Him. If you can't fast, say, look, I called my doctor. He said, don't do it. Come and pray with us. And then at 6 o'clock when we're done praying, or if the Spirit takes a little longer, if you want to stay up and pray, we're going to have some food brought in. We'll put it down. We'll set it up in the gym. We'll break the fast together. Of course, be smart. Don't overindulge because that won't be good. Don't feel good. But I want to challenge us as a church to do a church-wide fasting the best we can. If it can be all in and not eat anything, that's great. If you say, well, I can do this or that, I can skip this meal or that meal, that's great. Say, you know, I'm not capable, but I'm going to be praying with you. You know, maybe you can call some people who you know who are fasting and say, let me pray with you through this. But I'll be here Sunday night, and I'll pray with the church. You know, we often look for applications. Say, how can I apply the discipline of biblical fasting to my life? How can I apply what you preached about, Pastor Tom, to my life? Well, here it is. We're looking at it. We have it up here. And we can apply it to our lives together in unity for the glory of God, to grab back and claim the kingdom that belongs to God, to come together and do it together when we know the enemy's going to be pushing hard against us. But we can apply this spiritual discipline directly. I would really like you over the next 2 weeks to pray on this and say, Lord, I'm going to do this. And however you feel that you can participate. And we'll do this together. And we'll see what kind of work God starts. Maybe it's the start of something. As I said, it's time that we as the church claim back the ground that belongs to God and push back against the enemy. Amen. And the Holy Spirit is calling us, yes, as Grace Baptist Church, to start taking those steps. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we love you and we thank you and we praise you. Lord, I believe that you're starting something fresh and something new here in our church. Lord, we want to go to battle and claim what is your kingdom. Lord, for too long we have sat and watched the enemy move unhindered in our families, in our cities, in our communities, in our workplaces, and Lord, even in our churches. And let us as a people step up and say, Lord, bring me closer to you. Show me what you want. And yes, Lord, may we boldly say, Lord, show me your glory. As we begin claiming back what is rightfully yours and belongs to your kingdom forever and ever. Lord, I know that fasting is not popular, fasting is not easy, fasting is not something we're comfortable with. But Lord, start preparing in our hearts the next 2 weeks to take the steps that I believe and that your word clearly states will bring you glory, will bring us closer to you. Lord, not only will you touch us, but we will be so much closer that we can reach and touch you. Lord, I thank you. We love you. We praise you. And Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to sing one last time. As we do sing this song, if you have something on your heart, this altar is open. Thank you. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink?
Grow us as church, grow us closer to you. I'll leave you in Psalm 121, verses 7 and 8. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. The Lord will guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forever. We thank you, Lord. We love and praise you. And Jesus, in your name we pray.
Amen.